Fine Arts here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay. We're glad you're with us and want to invite you to join us in the call to worship.
Blessed are those who keep God's
testimonies, who seek God with their whole heart,
who also do no wrong, but walk in God's ways.
You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently.
Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes.
Then I shall not be put to shame, having my eyes fixed on all your commandments.
I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous ordinances.
I will observe your statutes. Oh, forsake me not utterly.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Good morning. I welcome you to our virtual worship service here at the 10:30 hour. Here on the North Shore, it is a beautiful sunny day. There's all kinds of people walking outside, so I know that some of you may be actually watching this later in the week. But whether you're watching it live or whether you are watching it later, what a blessing it is to be able to share this time together with you. I know that we gather virtually both as longtime church members here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay. And again, I'm just so thankful for the number of you who have adopted us as your church home during the time in which our sanctuary doors are closed. There is on your screen, hopefully, a text box where you can text in your items of joy or concern. One of the reasons that we really value worshiping live via live stream is that so we can have this interaction with one another. And so if you text in your prayer, Neil will be sure to read that and lift that up for the entire community. This is Memorial Day weekend. And on this weekend, we remember those lives that have been lost in the line of service. We know that on Memorial Day weekends, oftentimes cemeteries are filled with people and planting flags, and that may not be the case this year, but those dear men and women who have gone before us are never going to be forgotten. Well, last week we offered communion, and we had the health department and the village police department give us the thumbs up on the way in which we were going to do it. And oh, I wish it would have been a day like it is today. Last week, the rain was coming in sideways, and we stood out there for an hour and a half. My hands and my feet were pruned. It was very, very cold. But almost 60 very hearty souls came out. And they came out because they had a hunger and a thirst, a hunger and a thirst for their God. And the receiving of communion, the Eucharist, is an important part of that. And so what a blessing it was, almost 60 times, to be able to institute the Lord's Supper for those families or those individuals that came forward while waiting 7 feet apart from one another. We are going to have communion again outside on June the 7th, and hopefully it'll be a beautiful and warm day. But it wasn't just the nearly 60 folks who showed up to receive communion. There were many of you who took communion kits back with you to give to somebody who was shut in, to perhaps leave them on the porch and to say they are there for you to receive this communion. But the one that touched me the most was Barb Abraham came, and she didn't have an umbrella, so I gave her my Augusta National umbrella while she was waiting. And those of you who know Barb know she almost never comes here alone. But alone she did, and she received communion. And I gave her one of the kits to take home to her sister, Debbie. And I learned on Monday that Debbie was able to receive that communion in what would end up being only hours before she was born into eternity, was received into heaven by a gracious God. And so thank you to this church for making something like this possible, for something like this happening, the way in which it nourishes our soul. Well, it is our continued hope that we'll be able to gather together in live worship on June the 21st, but we just need to know it's going to look different, and worship is going to have to look different for a period of time as we kind of phase ourselves back in. We have an incredible team that is thinking strategically about how we are going to be able to offer this in ways that are safe for everyone. We don't want to jeopardize a single person. And so we are developing a worship covenant. And I hope you don't think of it as a list of rules that need to be followed if you're to worship with us, but just something that we agree together that we are going to covenant with so that we might continue to maintain a joy-filled worship experience. Tomorrow, which is actually Memorial Day, I know it's Memorial Day, but who has anywhere they can go? At 6:30 is our Zoom meeting to have a sermon talk back. If there's something that comes up in the sermon or something you didn't understand or something that you want to question boldly, I encourage that kind of dialogue. The link for that Zoom meeting is on our homepage, umcwfb.org. And so as we transition to time with our children, we have two really special treats that are going to be a video offering for us. The first is Tony Case, and Tony plays in our praise team. He plays the mandolin, he plays the guitar, he sings, and as you're going to see with his beautiful daughter, Sophia, he also plays the banjo. Did you know that? You did know that. I did not know that. Jack of all trades. And so after Tony and Sophia sing Yes, Jesus Loves Me, we're going to transition then into our children's time. I hope you enjoy these video offerings.
Start over.
Thank you. talking about encountering Jesus in the Bible. And I have asked some friends to help share some of their favorite Jesus encounters in the Bible.
Hi, my name is Claire, and one of my favorite Bible verses is John chapter 8, verse 12. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness.
Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Hi, my name is Blake, and one of my favorite Bible verses is Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do God's works, which God prepared in advance for us to do.
Joshua 1:9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go.
Thanks, kids, and thanks to Tony and Sophia for that special music. I'd like to invite you now to join me in prayer. Dear God, from the very beginning was your word which spoke this world into being. Your word which thunders from the skies. Your word which flows like mountain streams. Your word which whispers in morning breeze. You've revealed your word through kings and prophets, through angels' praise, in humble service, and through the voice of a tiny child. Your word, alive from the beginning of all things and to eternity. Dear God, your word is the light we see, a guide for our footsteps to where you are found. Your word is the strength we find when darkness threatens to overwhelm us. Your word is the power we need to become servants of a heavenly King. Your word is the reason we live in the sure knowledge that you are everything. I'd like to lift up the following prayers of our congregation. Prayers for those who are dying, for those who have passed, and for those who love them. Special prayers for Debbie and Barb Abraham and for Linda Van Stratton. A prayer of joy for 28 years of marriage with my beautiful wife, Janet Hadley. Continued prayers for a family in Florida as they mourn the death of their toddler. May God's grace and love and peace surround them and support them. A prayer of gratitude for the life of Jenny Haugen, who passed on to her eternal home last week. Prayers for comfort, peace, and strength for all of us struggling with anxiety and uncertainty during this time. Prayers for a very happy birthday to a husband. And a happy birthday to Blake Odie. Prayers of thanksgiving and joy on the birth of a granddaughter, Twyla Lee Ward. Grandma and Grandpa, Karen and Charles Wards, have full hearts. Prayers for a sister, Leslie, facing a second surgery for cancer this week. A prayer for a brother-in-law with brain cancer and for a sister suffering from depression. And a prayer of joy for parents celebrating their 33rd wedding anniversary this week. Prayers of healing for Lynn Raffensperger, who's dealing with a cancer diagnosis. May her doctors be guided with wisdom, and may she and Mike feel the love and peace of Christ. These are the prayers of our congregation. And now we unite our voices in the prayer that Jesus taught us all to say. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And amen. And so we come now to a time of offering. And we give of ourselves in so many different ways. Some of it through tithes and financial gifts. Some of it through our skills. And maybe just the time that we can share with somebody. There are multiple ways for you to continue your support here. And in this time where we have not been able to gather together, I really want to thank you for the ways in which many of you are continuing to remember us. That's going to help us that when we can all gather together, that we're not going to have to compromise anything we're doing here. Your gifts really do matter. And for those of you, and I say this almost every week, for those of you who are worshiping with us but are a part of a different community of faith, I pray that you are remembering your local church, that you are still giving your gifts, that you are still upholding the commitments and the pledges that you have made to that community of faith. And so as we are going to receive a musical offering through a video with Neil and Mary, and is Sue in this as well? Sue, no, not this one. So let us center ourselves and give ourselves to God in a time of offering. Thank you.
Before we receive our doxology, I just want to say a word. I had mentioned, is Sue a part of this? Because originally it was going to be Neil and Mary Paul and Sue Stanley. And we lifted up at the first service Sue's mother, Marilyn, who is in ICU right now with a blood clot. We want to continue to lift her up in our prayers. But now in response to all the gifts that God has given us and in response to our stewardship that we in turn give back, why don't we join together in singing our doxology?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
And so, dear God, we do give you thanks for the opportunity to be called stewards of your love, stewards of your gifts. Lord, help our giving to make a real impact in this world that is hurting so badly. All this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And so we come to a time of the service that we call the Word. And our Word is going to come to us today through a musical offering, through Scripture, and through proclamation. As we are receiving this song, Thy Word, I hope that you can center yourselves and that you can open yourselves up so that you're ready to be filled this day. Thy word is a lamp. Thank you very much, gentlemen. Thy word is a lamp to my feet. And that's very fitting for our sermon this day. We're in the second week of a sermon series called Encountering Jesus. And last week, we took a look at those encounters in our lives that really do matter. Those encounters that change the trajectory of our life, or maybe even kind of help to recreate who we are. And there is no encounter that is more powerful, that is more important than our encounter and our encounters with Jesus. And so in this series, we're looking at some of the ways in which, in some of the places that we do encounter Jesus. And today, it is through the Word. We encounter Jesus in the Bible. Now, today is May 24th. It's an appropriate day for us to have a sermon on encountering Jesus in the Bible. You see, we who are from the Wesley heritage, the Wesley tradition, we call this day Aldersgate Day. And we remember that on a May the 24th, in the evening, John Wesley went to a church down to the basement to hear someone read aloud Martin Luther's preface to the book of Romans to unpack Scripture. And it was through encountering Scripture that day that John Wesley, who is already calling himself a Christian, who is already actually an ordained priest in the Church of England, something happened to him that day. There was an encounter with Jesus that changed his life forever. It set him on fire for reform and for change. He said of that experience, "On this day, I felt my heart strangely warmed, and I knew that my sins, even mine, were forgiven of me." You heard during Neil's prayer time that today is my wedding anniversary. We were married on May the 24th, and I did not yet know that it was Aldersgate Day. So now we always kind of joke that, yes, on our wedding day, our hearts were strangely, strangely warmed. But in this sermon today, dear friends, I really want to encourage you to not let a single day go by without being in the book, without walking with at least one verse during the day and allowing God to illuminate new truths for you through it. Because I tell you the truth, we will never encounter Jesus in the Bible if we don't open up the Bible. That seems a little too simplistic, doesn't it? But it is true. We will never encounter Jesus in the Bible if we don't engage with the Bible. And I mean the whole Bible. All of the Bible teaches us about Jesus. And we can know Jesus because the Bible shows to us Jesus. Even hundreds of years before he was born, it cries out about him. Now, I heard a funny story. And someone once asked, "Do you know the difference between ignorance and apathy? Do you know the difference between ignorance and apathy?" And one man said, "I don't know and I don't care." And I wonder if he knew how true his statement really was. And that's how it is for many people, even people who have been going to church all their lives when it comes to the Word of God. They may say something like, "I don't know anything about the Bible and I don't care." How sad that is. And how dangerous that is for a church. Bishop William Willimon says this, "Congregations are formed by their confrontation with the Bible." He says, "Scripture forms us, reforms us, and challenges us, even as we hide from the Word, as we refuse to hear it, and as we avoid and evade the claims it makes upon us." If I read this book, I might actually be compelled to do what it says. Willman continues on, "Show me a vital and healthy congregation, and I'll point you to a people who take the Word of God seriously." So my question is, how are we doing, church? Do we take it seriously? Do we take the call and the demands upon our lives that it contains seriously? Now, I got the idea for this sermon series, Encountering Jesus, by reading and rereading a little book by a pastor named Zan Holmes. And although this is only loosely with what he says, he has some things that I want to share. And one of those was how in his own African-American heritage and tradition, especially in that struggle to free from slavery and to free from the racism that was and still is so oppressive, he said the Bible holds a very sacred place for the African Americans. Even throughout history, those who were illiterate, those who could not read, they would clutch their Bible and they would listen to the words as people explained exactly what the grace and the love of God is all about. He tells a story about one servant who was a maid in the house and how the daughter of that family taught her how to recognize J-E-S-U-S, Jesus. And she said, "Whenever you see that word in the Bible, that's the word that says Jesus." And so she would comb through it, and she would see the word Jesus, and it was a sacred spiritual discipline for her, even though she could not read. Now, for her, she was only in the New Testament part of the Bible. That's the only place we hear and read the word Jesus. But what I tell you is he goes throughout the entire book, the entire book. And so, friends, there are times that we limit our encounters with Jesus by only reading our favorite passages, only reading those feel-good kinds of things. But all of it contains the truth about this Jesus. And the Bible is the church's book. And I want to tell you, if you struggle by reading the Bible, it's probably because you're trying to do it all on your own. The Bible is meant to be studied with other people, whether a very small group or a large group in worship. The word comes alive when we have conversations with one another about what it means, and it then helps us to be even more faithful. And yet some of us don't want to be a part of a group of people that read the Bible because we're afraid that we may come across as knowing absolutely nothing. But until we acknowledge that we don't know everything, we're never going to have a mindset that says, I am open to learn. Throw something new on me, a new understanding. Help me grow in it. And when we do that, we see that the Bible and Jesus can be presented in such a way that they can move beyond just a heart strangely warmed for a moment, a warm, fuzzy feeling, and move into a deeper level of understanding. We can, says Zan Holmes, encounter Jesus who may not answer all of our questions, but who surely questions all of our answers that do not include his way, his truth, his life. It's about a God who draws straight with crooked lines and keeps a seat reserved for the table for those who have not yet found their way back home. Friends, that's the gospel truth. Even in the days of Jesus, the people who were of religious authority didn't quite understand everything that they were reading. In John chapter 5, verse 39, Jesus says to such a crowd, "You study the scriptures diligently because you think that in them you have eternal life. These are the very scriptures that testify about me." Another translation says, "But the scriptures point the way to me." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And all of Scripture is a testimony to Jesus Christ, who is himself the divine revelation. You see, Jesus is the definitive word of God. In the Greek translation, word means truth. John's gospel begins by saying, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things, came into being through him." You see, Jesus is God in the flesh, 100% human, 100% divine. That makes Jesus a 200%er, 100% human, 100% man, 100% God, God in the flesh. And this man knew his Hebrew scriptures. Adam Hamilton suggests that the Bible that Jesus would have known and had would have looked nothing like this, and we know that to be true. No, his Bible would have most likely been a collection of scrolls, and you could never carry them all around with you at the same time. Some guess that his scroll collection was probably 24 different scrolls, and we know that Jesus cited 23 of the books that we now call the Old Testament, which is more appropriately called the Hebrew Bible. But it was the book of Psalms, the prophet Isaiah, and Deuteronomy that he cited most often. Jesus, in his preaching and teaching that we have in the Gospels, he does not quote all parts of the Bible equally. Instead, he favors those passages that truly show God's mercy, not God's wrath, God's mercy. And he sees the scriptures as a foreshadowing to his own ministry. Case in point, in Ezekiel, and Ezekiel is one of those books that makes a lot of people nervous to read through there. In Ezekiel chapter 34, the prophet says that God's people are scattered. They are lost because they have no shepherd. And a little bit later in that chapter, he says, but God is going to raise one up. God is going to bring and provide a new shepherd. And along comes Jesus, who saw himself foreshadowed in this. Jesus comes back and he says, I am the good shepherd. And then he tells a story about a shepherd leaving the 99 who were all together to seek out, to search for that one who was lost. And man, I have been that one who was lost. Thanks be to God that this good shepherd came to show the way. Some scholars say there are as many as 365 prophecies from the Old Testament that Jesus fulfills. That's one a day. I just want to reiterate, all of the Bible teaches us about Jesus, and we can know Jesus because the Bible shows us Jesus, even the Old Testament. As a matter of fact, that's how Jesus taught about himself. Let's think about Easter Sunday just for a moment. Now, most of us think of the women running to the tomb, and he's gone, and people are there saying, he's not here, he's been risen, and then we think about the upper room, but on Easter Sunday, Jesus appears not in Jerusalem, but on a road, a common road, walking as others walked. He was headed to a place called Emmaus. And there were two people who lived in Emmaus, and he comes upon them, and they look distraught, and they say, are you the only one who doesn't know about what happened to this man named Jesus? We thought he was going to be the Savior. We thought he was going to be the Messiah. And Jesus must have smiled. But the scripture lets us know that beginning with Moses and all of the prophets, he interpreted to them things about himself in all the scriptures. The Gospels weren't written yet. Paul wasn't even converted yet. There was no New Testament, just these promises from God. And so after he vanishes from them, after breaking bread, these two men say to each other, were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us? You see, their encounter on that Easter is the same kind of encounter that we have with Jesus. Yes, there was the encounter through the breaking of the bread, through the Eucharist, or through communion, as we call it here in the Methodist Church, but also in the scriptures, the reading and hearing of the scriptures. And this is what Paul was trying to tell that young pastor, Timothy. In the second letter to Timothy, we hear Paul say this, "But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for the salvation through faith in Christ Jesus." The text he's talking about there isn't the New Testament, it is Old Testament. All scripture, says Paul, is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that everyone, even the least, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient and equipped for every good work. If you want to be proficient, if you want to be equipped for every good work, learn the book. Read the book. The Word of God, this book is, for the people of God, and thanks be to God. Well, there were others as the church began to spread. Indeed, they would start within Jewish communities and illuminate to them how the Old Testament prophecies were coming true. On Pentecost Sunday, they come bursting out of the upper room, and they are so filled with this exuberance and these languages that the crowd says, they're drunk. And Peter says, not yet, we're not. And then he begins to preach to them, starting with the prophets and then on to David. Stephen, just before he is stoned, stands up to his face, to their faces as he is witnessing to his faith, and he begins with the Old Testament. Philip, with the Ethiopian eunuch, begins with the prophets, and even Paul. Paul knew his scripture, and he says in the book of Acts, I teach nothing except what the prophets and Moses said would happen. If you want to know God, you need to know the scriptures. If you want to have an encounter with Jesus, you must do so in the scriptures. But some of you say, Pastor Matt, that book is archaic. There are things in there that I just cannot reconcile with what the church tells me Jesus is. Look at the Old Testament. God is so violent and bloodthirsty in the Old Testament. That is different than Jesus Christ, who is meek and who was humble. And friends, you have a real point. There are some things in the Old Testament that just ring wrong. I mean, think about it. In the Old Testament, there is from God given this death penalty, even for your own children. Your child does something so severe that you're called to be faithful and put them down? That doesn't sit right. Or what about this wrath and severe punishment for God's own people? If they're the chosen people, why would God strike them down and smite them? Or what bothers a lot of people, and rightfully so, are these commands to the Israelites to go marching into a land that was promised to them, but for hundreds and hundreds of years other people have been living in, that God seemingly commands Israel to commit genocide. This is tough. How do we reconcile that? I know it doesn't make my job easy, because the task before preachers and teachers of the Bible is to explain how the character of God in these harsh and violent texts is somehow consistent with the character of God revealed by Jesus. The human authors and the editors of the Old Testament, some say, brought their own experiences and their own presuppositions to the task of writing. Adam Hamilton argues, "My premise is that the Bible is the words of people who were influenced by God, and yet who are also shaped by the times in which they lived." He argues the violence attributed to God in the Bible is a serious issue. It is inconsistent with the character of God, and that Jesus Christ came to do something completely different. But it is the human story, so human, that throughout the ages, throughout history, we have tragically supported the use of violence to enforce the will of dictators, kings, and even the majority in democratic society. Violence and war in the Old Testament tells us, argues Hamilton, more about the people who wrote them and the times that they were living in than about the God in whose name they claimed authority to do these things. Friends, how easy it is for people of faith to invoke God's name in pursuit of violence and bloodshed and war. We give thanks for a new covenant. But friends, just because someone quotes scripture at you, it does not mean that what he or she says is from God or comes even close to God's will. Everything can be taken out of context. And so, do we know the scriptures? Do we believe them? Even the parts where we say, "Oh, come on, that's impossible." Do we? Some time ago, there was a little boy named Joey. And Joey, when he was 9 years old, went off to his Sunday school class. His parents always made sure he went to Sunday school each and every week. And then, like great parents, after Sunday school, the parents would talk with their children. Joey's mom would say, "What did you learn in Sunday school?" And if he got something a little bit wrong, she could gently teach him in the right way. "Thy word is a lamp upon my feet to light my path forward to truth." And so the lesson that morning was about Israel escaping the clutches of Egypt and the Pharaoh, going through the Red Sea. And so when she said, "Well, tell me about it," he said, "Well, okay, Mom, here's what the teacher told us." She said that God sent Moses behind the enemy lines on a rescue mission to lead the Israelites out of Egypt. When he got to the Red Sea, he had his corps of engineers build a pontoon bridge, and all the people walked across the bridge safely. And once they were on the other side, Moses took out his walkie-talkie to radio headquarters and called in an airstrike when the Egyptians were closing in on them. Then they sent bombers to blow up the bridge to destroy the enemy, and all the Israelites were saved. Now, how would you have responded if your child told you this? You know that mother knew the Sunday school teacher. And so she said, "Now, Joey, is this really what your teacher taught you?" And Joey said, "Well, no, Mom, but if I told it the way they did, you'd never believe it. Never believe it." It's true that parts of the scripture seem impossible to us, but that doesn't give us an excuse to dismiss it. We are called to engage. We are called to encounter. We are called to wrestle with it in order to be blessed. And so if you've kind of dozed off, or you maybe went to the fridge and you can still hear my voice echoing, I want you to come right back to your computer or to your smart TV, or look right in on your tablet or your phone, because I want to tell you something. You are not dishonoring God by asking questions of Scripture that seem inconsistent with modern science, knowledge, geography, or history. You are not being unfaithful to God if you ask questions of a verse that seems inconsistent with the picture of God seen in the life, the teachings, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Engage. Encounter. Be blessed. So what is your take on the Bible? How do you view it? There is a Barna group, and they really... poll quite often, and the last poll they said was, what is your view on the Bible to the people in the country? And in our country, 20% said the Bible is the inerrant word of God, no mistakes, no human interference with any of it. The majority, 52% when pressed, even people who maybe have never read the Bible, but they see their friends, they say, well, I believe it contains God-inspired truths. It reveals principles that we really need to have. We believe it's good for humanity. It's just not perfect. 19% say, no, it's just a book of wisdom written by human authors with no divine inspiration. But there's 13% in our country that are classified as Bible hostile. And they'll really get worked up if you even say the word Bible. 13% self-identify as believing that the Bible's sole purpose is to be used to manipulate and to control people. And in some cases, they have seen the Bible used to do that exact thing. And every time that happens, people in my position, you know, it's harder. It's harder. Some people, on the other hand, worship the Bible seemingly more than they worship the hero of the Bible. They worship the Bible, and they never live it out because they just worship the Bible. Their head is always down in it, but they never do anything that it would ask us to do. There's that old story of a Bible scholar who came to be a keynote speaker at a Bible college, and he could sense that no one was living out what was in the words, but everyone clutched their Bible. And so to try and make a statement, he picked up the Bible, and he threw it out of one of the open windows, and he said, "There goes your God." You can imagine the stir that created there. Then there's the others of us that just would never dare to wrestle with the text. But friends, we must wrestle with it, and we must wrestle with the call it has upon our lives. Soren Kierkegaard, a great existential thinker, I had an entire semester-long course on his writings and his teachings. Fantastic course. It was held at the seminary at Gettysburg in Pennsylvania, and I'd go up there and I'd do a little different part of the battlefield every morning, then have the class afterwards. But here's what Soren Kierkegaard said. He writes, "The Bible is very easy to understand, but we Christians are a bunch of scheming swindlers. We pretend to be unable to understand it because we know very well the minute we understand, we're going to be obliged to act accordingly. Maybe you don't read it because you fear it calls too much out of you." Mark Twain said, and I quoted this last week, "Most people are bothered by those passages in the Bible which they cannot understand. But as for me, I always notice the passages of Scripture which trouble me the most are those which I do understand." And he says that because he knows he needs to respond. Now, as Methodists, as Wesleyans, the Bible has always been central. There is this centrality of Scripture. You know, we live by this quadrilateral, these four things that we can do to know God's will in our lives, but the very first one, the foundation, is Scripture. Yes, we apply tradition and our experiences and our ability to reason, to think critically, but it begins with Scripture. The Bible is central because in and through it, we encounter God. The Bible is central because we share God's divine plan. The Bible is central because through it, we understand God's nature, which is this new covenant, salvation through Christ. The Bible is central because in it, we find all things necessary for holy living. which is why John Wesley himself said, I want to know one thing, the way to heaven, how to land safe on that happy shore. God himself has condescended to teach the way. For this end, he came from heaven. He hath written it down in a book. Give me that book at any price. Give me that book. Friends, this book is available. And when we open it, it is my prayer that we're not just looking for history lessons or a historical Jesus. It's my prayer that when we open it and that when we read it, we do so with an expect change of an encounter of change. So friends, don't let a day go by without being in the book, at least walking with one verse. We will never encounter Jesus in the Bible if we don't open the book. All the book shows us Jesus Christ, and that is great good news. Amen. And so we are going to sing our response to our spoken word this day as we join together in a hymn from our hymnal 178, Hope of the World. If this is a hymn you know, I invite you to belt it out at home with great joy. And so, dear friends, I hope you enjoy this holiday weekend, and I hope this is a week where you will open up the book, that you open up the book with an expectation of an encounter that is going to change you, that is going to feed you, and that is going to help to train you to be the person of God that you are called to be, forgiven, loved, and free. Have a great week. Goodbye.